right. Evan Ginsberg back with another edition of Evan Ginsberg's Legends TV. Always an eclectic mix, and you're going to see just that today as we present live blues, rock, R&B, poetry. Pro wrestlers are coming out later, but right now we have poet John Winnell, my co-host.
Hello.
And who's that on your shirt, John?
This is my more gothic Edgar Allan Poe. I had worn this one in a while, so it's more of the gothic, like an etching kind of a thing.
Nothing works better on a TV show than pro wrestling and Edgar Allan Poe. That's an interesting combination. And seated next to John, our very special guest, all the way from the Philippines, Eleanor Marie Barami. Did I pronounce your last name correctly?
Yes, you did.
There you go. And she's the unit production manager on a tremendous film called An Unstable Reality, and also a university lecturer and researcher. Very impressive.
Yes.
Very impressive.
Thanks for having me.
Oh, my pleasure. And a month or two back, I lose track of time because we've done like 200 shows. We had the cast and crew from An Unstable Reality right here on the show.
That's correct.
And update the viewers on the film itself. What's the theme?
Well, the theme of the film, general theme of the film, is really all about mental illness and how a woman who has been diagnosed with bipolar and schizophrenia is able to function in like a corporate setting, and how she was given the responsibility of like managing this company, and people around her kind of like knew about her conditions. So the question there was, okay, so how does she, take everything all together with her current condition?
The interesting thing, the sad thing, is I'll bet that there are more in that condition than actually are acknowledged, or that that's a scary thing to have to.
That's true. I mean, like, talk about diagnosis. Like, if you think about, like, are people diagnosed professionally or formally? Because some people who may feel or think that they have something, sometimes they would assume, and then they would like end up self-diagnosing,
which is dangerous as well, right?
Exactly.
Well, that's not uncommon. They say a lot of teenagers self-medicate. In the reality of somebody with chemical imbalance,
it's tough.
It's more common, than
what is put out there.
The degree of mental illness in society today, it's such a vast problem. My own mother has suffered off and on her entire life in and out of mental institutions. So personally, I can certainly relate to this and have been through an awful lot myself. She was institutionalized at one point for 14 months and, in and out of hospitals off and on with long periods where she was okay, where the medication kept everything stable. I'm going to ask both of you, because John's a psychologist as well, what would you suggest in our society to somehow improve all of this? Because it's a lot of people that are going through an awful lot.
It's a phenomenally complicated question and problem. And
you have to answer it in 2 minutes.
Well, the answer, it comes down to body chemistry and patience and awareness and acceptance. So with all of that and the right medication, which sometimes is a roll of the dice to see how the chemicals work with individual body chemicals. But again, acceptance, because there's so much shame about mental illness and so much that's still frowned upon.
That's true.
So acceptance is the primary thing. The chemical stuff has to be done properly, and even that can be misdiagnosed. I mean, it's very complicated.
Right. And I think for me, like coming from a country where we're still advocating and still fighting for laws for mental health, like there's this advocacy going around now in the Philippines, which is we need mental health laws to cover people with mental health issues. At the same time, like I worked in New York City as well as a special ed teacher, and I know that in some cases, with like the kids at least, there are some services that aren't covered in their parents' insurance. So it's really expensive.
Right.
It's mostly out of pocket. And I think like on top of the awareness and like the advocacy, I think I don't want to go into politics here, but it's hard not to.
You know, that's, I mean, that's really an issue right now, especially right now, mm-hmm. politics as far as medical care for
yes.
all, health care for, I mean, mental illness is very real, and, you know, that is a big problem, you know. Do the parents, you know, take their kids outside where they're spending, you know, an arm and a leg if they don't have the
mm-hmm.
insurance, or does everything fall back on the school system,
yep.
which then you burn people out,
mm-hmm.
and, you know, so you get quality people doing less quality, so, you know, there has to be more money
yes.
put into the understanding, acceptance,
mm-hmm.
and care for mentally ill, you know, kids and teens and adults.
And speaking of politics, on the other end of the spectrum,
mm-hmm.
you constantly hear Black Lives Matter, All Lives Matter, Blue Lives Matter. Mm-hmm. How about Elderly Lives Matter, where they dump somebody in a nursing home, dope them up, they're staring at the wall, you know, all day,
mm-hmm.
you know, throw them in a bed where, you know, they're almost like a prisoner for the next 8 to 12 hours. How about something to help the elderly as well, because mm-hmm. the mental illness, Alzheimer's, etc., so on.
Exactly.
You know, there's unlimited money to blow up countries, but how about helping these people?
Uh-huh. Yep,
you know, maybe, I mean, there's always been a dilemma. When Ken Kesey wrote One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, which had a political
mm-hmm.
and, you know, and a social, that was what written in, you know, in the 50s. And who was, did a famous film, I think he's 90 now, he did the documentary on mental health, on hospital, and the neglect of patients because, you know, what is it, poor, elderly.
That was the film at Creedmoor, correct?
Well, that might have been at Creedmoor, which was, That infamous case, and then that other infamous case with Geraldo Rivera. I worked with some of those kids, God knows, 40 years ago. That, you know, that the people are neglected
mm-hmm.
because it's mental illness is a. It shouldn't be a stigma, but it is stigmatized. I mean, there has to be awareness. The public need to be
right.
more aware. You know, whatever, through the arts, through painting, through talking,
mm-hmm.
through dancing. Through poetry and music, I mean, it has to, I mean, it's healing. I mean, that's something. It has to be more of an awareness. And America, as great of a country as this is, and as advanced as America is, and Philippines is really, it's an American, yeah, it's a...
what we were a colony of the year.
Unfortunately, everything was a colony, but they're independent and,
right.
I mean, there has to be money put in. I mean, you know, it can't just be for the gain of the almighty, you know, which of course is a reality too, because things need to thrive and there has to be money to pay for everything.
Right.
But you can't neglect all of these people
yeah.
that have been neglected.
The other thing is we're a very youth-oriented society and you always hear about teen suicide. The highest rate of suicide are adults in their 50s. They wake up one day, they're caretakers for their parents who are fading. They're dealing with their family issues. They may be divorced. They may have money issues, job issues. There's a huge suicide rate of people in their 50s. And speaking of awareness, how about action? You know.
Well, but awareness brings action. What I think people need to do is really, I mean, I think people have gotten away from simple things.
Mm-hmm.
Reading or just feeding your own mind to be an independent thinker. You become an independent thinker and you realize the possibilities that you have for yourself, that life isn't as much of a dead end as you would think it is. People become, you know, like blinders on the horse.
Mm-hmm.
You think you're just focused in one direction, but if you build up your own person, you know, with interest, you realize the possibilities are there.
Right.
And of course, you have to have friends so you don't feel that dark shadow hanging over you, where it can, you know, with your elderly parents. I mean, we all have that. As we get older, onto that cycle, 50s, our parents, you know, become ill and it's, you know, they're frail and we lose our friends. Then you deal with the next generation, the youth, the problems that they're having. It's very hard. You have to take time. Everybody should take time out for themselves. 5, 10, 15 minutes every day. Do something that you love to do. Read, write,
meditation,
sing.
Tai Chi.
Oh yeah, and that human connection. I think that's what our society lacks.
Yes.
Like right now, like technology's like everyone's always on their phones, and there was a study a couple of years ago that said people who actually don't have a Facebook account or don't have like social media, they seem to be more just like happier, you know, because they don't see other people's lives and like compare their lives and be like, oh, I'm miserable. Oh, look at this person's traveling.
Plus, we're constantly fighting over politics on Facebook. Everybody's divided.
Friendships are ruined because of
I've lost cousins.
I can
putting out xenophobic stuff on Facebook.
Uh-huh.
My wife's Korean. I just won't accept that.
Well, you know, it's true. You know, people stopped communicating. You have to have more of these. You know, there used to be forums.
Uh-huh.
You know, go out. Go, you know, do things with other people.
Right.
See a show or even go to the movies or go to a concert or, you know, read a book. You know,
and even like during like shows, like you'll watch like a Broadway show. Like I watched a show like a few days ago, and like everyone was on their phones. Like
people
were older.
They're staring at the phone in the middle of the show.
I know, and the phones are ringing, and like you see them like texting and like tweeting everything.
And that light is distracting.
I guess it wasn't that good of a show. Right?
It was really good. Yeah. I think they were
it wasn't
just, like,
Hamilton,
too excited.
Right?
No, it wasn't too expensive. I couldn't afford that.
So what we're going to do right now is see a clip from An Unstable Reality, and tell us first of all what is the goal that what made you decide to do this film?
Well, this is a collaboration between my husband and I. Like, I work in special ed, and that's my passion. Like, and I'm an advocate for it. And same thing with him, because he had friends who are still going through this, you know, this cycle of like, you know, having to figure out like how they can function in society. And so we decided to kind of like, you know, put our ideas together, and like he wrote the script, I kind of like reviewed it, and then we finally decided to put it out as a short film. And I think like the main goal of this is really for like awareness, especially in the Philippines. I know it would help a lot, like we send it out to other festivals internationally, but I think for the Philippines, like this is huge, because it'll really make people think twice about interacting and dealing with people with mental illness.
Is there still a stigma as far as, oh, I go to the psychiatrist?
Totally. Like, that's not an open thing back home.
Okay.
To them, if you're seeing a shrink, it's like, oh my gosh, you're crazy.
It's very
And it's so sad, because even for teenagers who have to go through, you know, all these, like, process and, like, evals and assessments, and they're scared to admit that they're going through something like this. So it's really unfortunate.
Okay, so let's check out the clip, An Unstable Reality, folks.
Are there any other issues? Do you think we're being followed? What's going on? Someone's calling me.
Be fucking mindful of the meds you take. Because right now, you're living an unstable reality.
I'm calling the cops.
No! No!
Do you want me?
An Unstable Reality, ladies and gentlemen. I've seen this film, quality film. I recommend it. It reminded me very much of Homeland with Claire Danes.
Yes.
Yes, yes. And do you hope eventually to expand it to full length?
Yes, that's in the works. We're waiting for results of some of the festivals that we sent it to, and then when proper funding comes in, definitely like make it a full length film.
There you go. We have something in common. I was a special ed teacher some 30 years ago. For 1 year, I would come home at 4 o'clock, exhausted, take a 3-hour nap, So much respect to the special ed teachers out there.
Yes,
not easy. Not easy.
It's not an easy job.
I moved on to adult education, and some of the adult students had their own issues.
Oh yeah, they do. Definitely.
But very rewarding, and we live in a society that demonizes teachers, and everything's about testing, and you know, all I could say to the teachers, you are ripples in a stream. You help people, they help their children, they help their children. I have nothing but respect for educators. And speaking of which, tell us about your own work on the college level.
Yes, so right now I'm currently a university instructor and I train teachers to be special ed and preschool teachers.
Okay.
And I also do research, which is related to the special ed side of my job. So currently the research that my team and I are working on is to be able to give proper assessments and evaluations to kids in the public schools in the Philippines.
Sure.
So I work with...
Difficult work.
It's really tough. Three other special ed teachers. I work with an occupational therapist, a speech therapist, audiologist, a psychologist. It's a whole team.
And in the Philippines?
In the Philippines. Oh, okay. It is in the Philippines. So we're in one institution, in one university, and we work collaboratively.
Good.
And then we visit different public schools in the entire country.
Right.
So it's a lot of work.
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to put you on the spot now, and feel free not to answer if you care not to. But we see a lot of criticism of administrators in the school system.
Mm-hmm.
We see a lot of criticism of teachers in the school system. My question is, what responsibilities do the parents have? Because I've read insane statistics like a kid will get 1,500 text messages in the course of the week, emails, phone calls, video games. I mean, how could a kid focus and study and do his best when there's a constant, you know, bombardment of stimuli?
Right.
What are the parents' responsibilities as far as their kids' education? And
well, I think parents play such a huge role. Like for me as an educator, I see parents as my resource. Like for me, they're the most helpful people. Like they know their kids, like inside out. I'm with the kids like 8-12 hours a day. They're with their kids like for the rest of the time. And so I've always recognized the importance and the information that the parents give us as teachers. And I think like they're the primary advocates of their kids. Like we support them. We're just really support as teachers. But parents, like they need to speak up,
right.
You know, they need to speak up and be like, you know, this is what's happening in the home. Now my child is experiencing ABC. So what can the school do? And it's the school's responsibility to respond to that. Although that's like in an ideal setting.
Of course.
But if you look at the realities of what's happening in the school system, because of also the work that's given to the teachers, it's just so hard.
Endless paperwork.
Well.
People don't grasp that a teacher is secretary, a counselor, a psychiatrist,
everything.
A surrogate parent in certain respects.
That is so true. So it's not easy. It's not easy. But I think the bottom line here is collaboration, respect, especially respect. Like that's a huge thing because I think I've experienced and I've seen teachers and parents not, you know, not being in good terms at the end of the year, and which is
I've seen circumstances where a parent will walk in, my boy's a good boy, and the teacher's like, well, he's not a good boy in here, you know.
Right.
You can't just blame the teacher.
Uh-huh.
But it shouldn't come down to one conversation.
That's true.
In the best situation, there's a constant dialogue between the home if they're open to it. I'm talking about, of course, the ideal situation.
Mm-hmm.
It's not always that way, you know. And with schools where there's not involvement, it's much more difficult. Where you're going to have that conversation, that conversation never should exist. In the best circumstances, of course, what you're saying is true. There has to be this open, ongoing, where there shouldn't be all of a sudden a surprise, where people are not aware of what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
So, in the best situation, where everybody's on board and everybody's understanding what's expected, what's going on, the give and take, there's an understanding, but it's very, very difficult.
And I think like putting the interest of the child first, sometimes as teachers, I must admit, we forget that because we're like, oh, you know, like tests or whatever, like
it's
administrators.
Very hard.
And then parents also, they tend to get overwhelmed, which is understandable, especially
sure.
if their child is going through something. So yeah. I think like just having that mindset of think about the child, like what is it that they need?
Right. I mean, that's what, you know, the evaluate. But even, you know, what you brought up, of course, in the schools, you live with the kids 8 hours.
Mm-hmm.
Parent has to deal with that kid that has God only knows what
mm-hmm.
going on for 16 hours a day, where they're not sleeping, where,
mm-hmm.
they, where they're not eating, where they're fighting with X, Y,
possible
and Z.
Drug and alcohol issues.
That too, that
mm-hmm.
other issue, pregnancy issues.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, many, many. So it's. But I think, I mean, I didn't have the courtesy of seeing your film, but I understand, you know, that, and I think if it's a film that's out there, it's a public message, and that's its purpose.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, when Charles Dickens wrote Oliver Twist in the 18, whenever, 50s or
mm-hmm.
earlier, that was also a message to the public on how children are not being treated
mm-hmm.
properly. The poverty of London. So again, that of course the medium was the ink, the, you know, paper
mm-hmm.
and words were the medium, but now we have a more powerful
right.
medium of internet, television,
mm-hmm.
video, movies to really bring a message to a vaster audience
right.
probably in one showing what you know, 6 months of what reading would be.
Mm-hmm.
So the idea of giving the message that to pay attention, to be sensitive, that people are going through these travails, that how difficult it is,
mm-hmm.
that it's chemical, and so to sensitize and not demonize
right,
people
exactly.
with mental illnesses,
exactly.
it's very important. I mean, if it's successful, I tip my hats in the other room,
right.
but I'll tip it to you here.
And my observation from this conversation is, instead of having political hacks running various school mm-hmm. systems, we should have people like you guys, experienced, caring.
We did,
well,
and they didn't want us
yeah,
to.
Yeah,
but I mean, running the entire show, you guys understand from top to bottom how it all works.
Well, that's why they didn't want me to go, but
right.
Such as I met Norman Lear last week at Truth last
mm-hmm.
Saturday, the guy who brought Archie Bunker to the world.
Maud, the Jeffersons.
And I met him and actually made him laugh. And his theory was over and next. Something is over. And he said, to quote Norman, Mr. Lear, out of respect, so there should be a hammock between over and next, meaning something is done.
Mm-hmm.
And you move on
right.
to what the next chapter of
uh-huh.
your life is, and that's healthy too. You need to make a healthy resolution.
Mm-hmm.
So we all go from one to another, and you know, you're going from the edge. And I think, you know, I try to put the people that I've met into my poems and
mm-hmm.
that compassion. And I think your knowledge and sensitivity is going into the film, and it'll make it that much
mm-hmm.
more valid. So again, over and next. To quote
yeah.
Mr. Norman
mm-hmm.
Lear, the great Norman Lear.
Yeah, you gotta move out. You gotta move to the bigger, you know, the bigger society. You can't just like keep it all to
no.
yourself.
And
yeah.
speaking of next, you could see John Winnell with Projection Zero August 19 at the Mousetrap Cafe, 203 Broadway in Amityville. John will be doing poetry with two world-class musicians. Carsten Rathke is from Germany all the way to the Mousetrap Cafe in Amityville. World-class jazz artist with Blaise Willow, one of the leaders in avant-garde jazz. It's going to be an incredible night. And Robert Ross is coming to the Mousetrap Cafe. Edwin Vasquez, world-class musicians. So Mousetrap Cafe, they're going to be open every night of the week with music 3-4 nights a week. So support the Mousetrap Cafe in Amityville. And John, plug your book real quick.
Okay, yeah. It's the one on the table, Poems for Everyday People. And it's available through myself, John Winnell, JONWINELL, at Facebook or at Yahoo, or then there's a store in Manhattan on Prince Street, McNally Jackson. They also have an unlimited, they can print them for you on demand if you like it. I'm gonna try to read, I'm gonna read something from the book and some newer things, contemporary things today. So if you're interested.
And my book, Apartment 4, Be Like in Brooklyn, about the turbulent East Flatbush Brooklyn of the 60s and 70s. If you think it's racially charged today, you should have lived through the 60s and 70s, right, John?
Sure.
And Eleanor, please plug anything you want to plug.
Yeah, Unstable Reality, we have a website. It's aurmovie.com, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, so you can like search that on Google. So hopefully it'll be out soon to like a wider audience.
And shout out to your husband. We've been going back and forth on instant message. Yeah. He's a good man.
He is. Very hardworking.
And we wish you nothing but success with the film and your educational endeavors as well.
Thank you so much.
And folks, when we come back, we're going to totally shift as we tend to do here on Legends TV. We're going to go to wrestling, poetry, live blues, live rock. It's going to be hot, folks. Don't you dare go anywhere. More of the eclectic mix known as Legends TV after this very brief commercial timeout. Don't you dare go anywhere.
Galaxy Luxury Coach is a full-service limousine and party bus company. Family-owned and operated, we are an industry leader with over 25 years of experience in providing best-in-class luxury transportation for your special event. Whether it's your precious wedding day, an all-day wine tour out east, your high school prom, that special birthday, or just an amazing night on the town, our professional chauffeurs stand ready to ensure your special event is truly special. Galaxy Luxury Coach has one of the largest and modern party bus fleets in the New York area. Our party buses are simply nightclubs on wheels, concert sound systems, light shows, lasers and strobes, multicolor LED lighting brilliantly lights your party bus inside and out. For corporate and more laid-back events, we will cater to your specific needs and requests. What sets Galaxy aside from all others in the luxury transportation industry is our attention to detail in customizing our services to your special event. At Galaxy, it's all about you and your guests. Galaxy customers return time and time again because they know they can trust Galaxy to help deliver those lifetime memorable moments. Step aboard and let your Galaxy experience begin.
For nearly a decade, Evan Ginsberg's Legends Radio has featured interviews with the greatest names in the arts and sports. Heard worldwide at legendsradio.net, the program has featured these great musical legends: Ray Manzarek of the Doors, Billy Corgan of Smashing Pumpkins, Judy Collins, Roberta Flack, and many more. Stars from movies, TV, and comedy have included Jenny McCarthy, Wayne Brady, 30 Rock's Judah Friedlander, Shelley Berman, Jackie the Joke Man Martling, David Alan Greer, and Paul Mooney. Stars of pro wrestling and MMA include Bruno Sammartino, Rowdy Roddy Piper, superstar Billy Graham, and Frank Shamrock. Co-hosted by renowned journalist Dr. Mike Leno, Legends Radio is heard Wednesdays 7 p.m. to 9:20 p.m. Eastern Standard. We are archived 24/7 with hundreds of hours of classic interviews. Legends Radio also features the best in indie music, showcasing talent deserving wider exposure.
I'm from Brooklyn, baby. Don't forget the gravy. We are soldiers.
You missed the birth of your mother and father. Don't you dare miss Evan Ginsberg's Legends Radio.
Including vinyl chain link, and Alumis offers a custom powder-coated system that prevents rust throughout the life of the fence. We carry fence tools to the trade. We even stock wood, rail, and glass hardware as well. Shannon Gates has our very own patented locking system. The next time you need fencing of any sort, both commercial and private, give Shannon Gates a call at 631-392-3000. 4330. You can also visit our website at shannonbeatsinc.com.
For professional motorcycle transport and towing, think Kickstart Fabrications Motorcycle Towing. Proudly serving all of Long Island, we feature expert handling and 24/7 service. So send a limo for your toy with Kickstart Fabrications Motorcycle Towing.
Back with Legends TV, an eclectic mix as always. We have poets and filmmakers and pro wrestlers from Lucha Libre Promotions. We have CEO Javier Clorio. Please introduce your crew.
Hi, well, I'm Javier Clorio, a gringo loco, saver, and el padrino.
There you go. And bringing Lucha Libre to New York, yours truly, I was the associate producer on the film The Wrestler with Mickey Rourke, and I've been to Lucha Libre at the Auditorio de Tijuana. Talk about atmosphere. I mean, it's I love Lucha. I love Lucha. And tell us what your goal is bringing it to New York.
So we started 3 years ago. We started with our first event. I saw that there was a need for Mexican Lucha Libre here. Sorry, getting a little complicated because you have to bring people from outside. It's expensive, and I did not know if the market was ready for it. So, you know, I started marketing. So I did a big marketing campaign. I was able to get, you know, TV stations to be part of it, radio, and then we started doing the shows. We're going on our third year now,
wow.
And we've been doing a lot of Lucha Libre. We brought in, you know, big stars, but I think that the most important part is what we have here, what we have created. People now come in to see Lucha Libre Promotions for the people we have working with us right now.
I went to one of your shows, and I love the fact that the audience, it was so old school. They hated the heels, they loved the faces. It reminded me of when I was a kid in the 70s, when everybody were true believers, you know? It was a good feeling.
Were you one of the guys throwing cans at me?
No, I was one of the guys appreciating the whole thing.
Okay, great.
And I'm assuming as the Gringo Loco, you're a heel, I would assume.
Oh, yeah, I'm one of the top heels here, you could say, at Lucha Libre Pro. Now, I've been wrestling for about 10 years myself. I go as a Jersey kid, also go as Gringo Loco. I got, you know, I use different names, different places at times. I just happen to be the Lucha Libre promotion champion.
That's a beautiful belt.
Yep, thank you very much. But, you know, I've been doing American wrestling for so long, you know, for 10 years now. And, you know, I was trained with basic American pro wrestling, you know, the basic, like the 80s pro wrestling, you know what I mean? Like the Hulk Hogan's, you know, that kind of style. And just like doing the Lucha Libre, it's just so much more fast paced. You know, you got to be like fully involved in the match. You know, you got to be like constantly thinking. It's just like so much more of a challenge. You know what I mean? Than just like the regular American pro wrestling. Not that I'm knocking pro wrestling, you know, it's great. You know, everything is great, but the Lucha Libre, you know, it's just so quick. You know, it's amazing. You know, the things that we could do in there, all the flips, it's incredible.
So I'm going to throw this out to everybody. As a fan of Rey Mysterio, I actually saw him when he was a kid at the Auditorio de Tijuana, before he was famous. Here's my question. Isn't it really like you're one move away from a serious injury with all the high flying?
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's just pro wrestling.
In general.
The most stepping off a ring could really hurt you, you know? Wrong step and you're hurt. I mean,
Greg Valentine got hurt walking up the ring steps. The steps collapsed. He had a serious injury.
You can be so focused on your match and just one little sidestep, man, you don't even get to have that match. It's Lucha Libre. It's its own world.
Yeah, that's why, you know, all these guys, man, you know, everybody who does, especially Lucha Libre wrestling, you know, we're always constantly training. You know, we always got to be in the ring, you know, working on, you know, even just doing roles, you know, because there's times where someone will pick me up and they could, you know, I've been dropped on my head before.
Yeah.
And you know what? But it's just, you know, I've been doing this pro wrestling for so long that somehow I have an instinct to where I could roll out of it and somehow not break my neck.
And what people don't realize is when you land on your head, it's just like the cartoons. You see the stars, the colors.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, like a big guy, you know, like, you know, a lot of guys watch the WWE and, you know, you see all these big guys in there. Okay, big guy against big guy. Oh, he's barely hitting them. Well, let me tell you, man, when I wrestle those big guys, when they hit me, they knock me. It's like, whoa, you got to remember where you're at for a second and you know, get back in the match. So.
And tell us about the tradition of masked wrestling. It's such a huge part of Lucha.
Absolutely. With the mask, it's part of the tradition. It definitely comes from the culture. It's part of the storytelling. They used to have the ancient tribes, and they used to compete to establish dominance. And instead of the title, it was the dominant tribe. So we continue that storytelling now with the masks, and it allows the people to relate, and for us to be able to tell the story and just kind of keep everyone captivated. I mean, especially with the kids, it's very popular. It gives us these larger than life characters that allows us to go out there and almost like a superhero, become someone else and be that person that they want to support, that they want to see bad or good. So
it goes back to like Aztec, Incan, Aztec. Stuff like that?
Absolutely.
I was in Mexico.
That is absolutely the...
As long as you don't eat each other's hearts. Like
yeah. Eat your heart match. That's hardcore.
Pro wrestling is the most ancient sport. You know, wrestling is the most
cavemen
ancient sport.
Cavemen wrestled.
Everybody,
have a caveman, actually.
So. We had the caveman on the show. He's great.
He's one of the guys that started with us back in 2013. We have a pretty solid core roster. I mean, we rotate around, of course, you know. But most of our main guys are just so hardworking. I mean, when we started, it was just an idea. Right. It wasn't supposed to run this long. But the idea just blossomed. Like I said, New York was missing Lucha Libre. You have a lot of pro wrestling in New York. Now, back when I started, you had one gym. You had to travel to Jersey with a couple of buses.
Right.
You know, on a Tuesday and a Thursday, right after work, come back at midnight, try not to miss that bus, because otherwise it's going to be a rough night.
Yeah.
Now in New York, man, there's no excuse not to be training. There's like a ring everywhere.
Wow.
There's in Brooklyn, Queens, Manhattan. It's evolving, but there's no Lucha Libre. There's the feature of it. People like the mask in their show, but it's a bigger risk where, like, do you put in an American wrestling show and feature two luchadors? Or let's do a whole Lucha Libre show and then feature a Gringo Loco. And it's, for the market, for the Mexican market, it's like, oh, that's for us. Our show's in Spanish. Our wrestlers speak Spanish. We have wrestlers that don't speak Spanish, but it attracts the crowd, you know?
Yeah.
That's the name, right?
It's something that makes you go, wow, this is... I can see American wrestling on TV. You don't even see Mexican wrestling on TV anymore.
Right.
It's not on, at least not in New York. You have to have like satellite or stuff like that.
It used to be on Galavision all the time.
Back in the day,
AAA.
So every Saturday you had an hour of CMLL, an hour of AAA. Now, God bless the internet, because that's how you get most of your wrestling now. You know, but here in New York, for the family to go out, take their grandmother, their kids, I mean, everybody gets involved. Their emotions run. That's the reason why we're able to perform in our shows, you know? I mean, you were there. That live crowd energy, just kind of like whatever you're going through that morning, you know, you come out of work at 5 in the morning, you go sleep, take a shower, come back, and you have to be there by 10 o'clock because we run early. We run a family show, noon. Our next show is at 4 o'clock. You know, we're not trying to get home, get the kids home late, you know?
Right, right.
And just that energy of that crowd, they're alive. They don't want to be critics. They don't want to go in and tell you how to do your job.
Yeah, it's not the snarky internet fans. Oh, these are real fans. Beautiful. Yeah,
they're coming out here and they're just enjoying themselves. And at the end of the day, you know, they'll throw a can at him.
Can tomatoes,
right?
Yeah.
They'll throw a taco at him. Last time, you know, they're throwing tacos and there's meat landing on me.
Yeah.
But as soon as that show ends and they're done cursing him out, the kids are just running towards him. Oh my God, I want to take a picture with
them. Yeah.
Why? Because they're so accessible, you know? People are seeing guys on TV, but now they're watching them live, and, you know, they could take a picture with the guy that was just booing, and they're going to have a good time. And
indie wrestling is probably, along with minor league baseball, the best live entertainment value you're going to find. For the price of a movie ticket, you're seeing a three-hour live show or more, 3 hours or more. You're meeting the wrestlers, getting autographs, taking pictures, up close and personal. You know, you go to a baseball game at Yankee Stadium or whatever, and you're spending hundreds of dollars. It's a great entertainment value.
Right. I mean, I think that's what's the wonder about our profession, is that we are allowed to be so closely related to the public and to the fans. I mean, that's pretty much our job, is to make sure that we connect with those fans for them to come back. I mean, it's great. It's fantastic. I don't see anybody else really making that connection the way that we do in professional wrestling. Now, in all sports, you have the media and you have these athletes speaking to the public. But a wrestler's going to go into the crowd. He's going to shake your hand. He's going to say, "Hey, do you want to take a photo? Hey, let's take this photo up." You know, we're gonna be more than just the athlete. We're going to be that person that you want to know inside and outside of the ring.
You remind me very much of Tiger Mask. I was at the Garden the night that Tiger Mask wrestled Dynamite Kid. I think it was 1982. We sat there. We were like stunned. We used to see these giant heavyweights go after Backlund, Bruno, etc. All of a sudden, you got Tiger Mask and Dynamite Kid. We were just blown away.
Right, and it's funny. I was watching a Tiger Mask match just the other night, and it's just, it's so... It's a wonder to watch him work, because in a time where all these super heavyweights were really the main attractions, just these larger-than-life guys go out there and kind of kill each other, but then you had a Tiger Mask come, and all of a sudden the pace starts to change. You start seeing faster movement. You start seeing some high
flying,
some
projects. They were ahead of their time.
Absolutely ahead of their time. That's exactly what I said. It's just... It's phenomenal to have watched him work at that time the way he did.
And speaking of phenomenal, my favorite active wrestler right now is Nakamura. I don't think anybody touches this guy. Tremendous. Tremendous.
I mean, in-ring skill, outside performance, overall package, you know? I mean, the guy comes in and that energy is just...
I mean, this guy's got it all.
He's bringing something different. And it's that overseas talent and that presence, that in-ring presence. And he just
charisma.
Has his following that comes with him. Yeah, and so, I mean, that's a great investment right there.
Nakamura and AJ Styles at Wrestle Kingdom was wrestling elevated to an art form. That's the match I would show to people if they, "Oh, that wrestling, that's stupid." Yeah, if you watch WWE, a lot of it is stupid.
It goes back to, like, the bigger sports thing, you know. The WWE, you have to realize, those guys have a TV show on Monday, on Tuesday, and I think on Wednesdays, right? Then they have house shows probably the rest of the week. They have these guys that are going in every night. They have to do promotion, television, travels, commercials, whatever it is, just to promote the company.
It's a very intense schedule.
They're not going to go out there and risk, you know, this $1 million investment. Just, you know, I mean, we get to go out there and do what we want to do, you know, have real fun wrestling, you know, like the good old stuff. You know, the guys don't get censored.
Right.
Guys, this is your objective. This is the match. Go do your art. Do what you do.
And going back to what they were saying, when I created this, Mexican Lucha Libre is a popular sport. It was created for the masses. Right. So it was created to, you know, tickets were cheap, you go out, you have a good time, you bring the family.
Right, right.
Then, you know, what happens here in the States is everything is marketing, right?
It's all corporate.
So it's all, you know, becomes expensive. You got to go out there. You want
They're charging $125 for an autograph and picture at SummerSlam. One autograph and picture. $125. That's disgusting greed mongers. I'm sorry.
And it is, at the same time, I do see it as a business because this is not my hobby. This is my, you know, it's my business.
But you don't want to bleed the public.
Exactly. Yeah. You want to give them, like, you know, hey, if you do want to, there's this option. But if you can still come, it's still going to be, you're going to get to watch people that are on TV, people, and be up close in a venue. I picked a really nice venue because I wanted people to come out and feel comfortable.
Laboom.
Laboom.
And give the address.
5615 in Northern Boulevard in Woodside, Queens.
Easily accessible, bus, trains, everything's right there. I live in Queens.
So.
And, this is next Sunday?
This is next Sunday.
Right. We're give actually, the date.
On the 24th, right. July 24th, we're bringing in Pentagon and Phoenix.
Wow, that's which the is real deal. Yeah.
One of the hottest matches right now out there. We're bringing in a special challenger for Gringo from Lucha Underground, a surprise challenger.
Okay, so as the promoter, I have a couple of questions as far as promoting itself. A surprise challenger, wouldn't it be better to have the name on the poster to draw more people?
You would think.
No, because it's still, you still want to go and watch the show live. You want to find out. I mean, I understand now you have the internet and you have, but the internet is fun and it's cool, but you still got to have that human interaction. So you want to find out what's going on,
okay,
come to our show.
Fair
don't
enough.
You know, you're watch big, it on TV.
You're a big wrestling fan, right?
I'm a huge wrestling
How
fan.
How often are you still surprised? When stuff
happens. I'm surprised when it's good. WWE is so stultifyingly bad most of the time. So when I go to an indie show, I enjoyed your show. I went to one of your shows recently. And the intensity, the fans hated the heels, loved the faces. They were emotionally involved. They cared, you know, who won, who lost. They were outraged when something devious was done to the face. It was old school and it worked. It
if
worked.
I'm correct, you came down for War of Nations, which was the first time we decided to make three teams, you know, United States, Mexico team, and international team. And let's have a tournament through the night. You know, each one racks up wins for the tournament. And that's probably why everybody was so like, every match matters to the fans, because the Mexican fans, no matter what, they want to see Mexico win.
Well, you have to care. You know? That's the basis. You have two boxers fighting. You have to care. You have two wrestlers wrestling. You have to care. Otherwise, you know.
And the thing is, our audience is completely different because we don't, the way we do the show is that when we're having this show, these are great matches, but we don't plan out us into like marketing more. Like, for example, we mentioned WWE. It's time because you want them to cheer for someone. If they're not, lower the volume on the microphones. Do this production wise so it comes out on TV.
It's like the world's worst talk show, WWE. They're endlessly talking.
Yes, and we want to have good matches. Right. They come out, we do have the talking, but not as much. Like, don't bore me with 30 minutes, man. Just give me a.
So speaking of talking, we have stand-up comedians. We're an arts program, not a wrestling program per se. Stand-up comedians are very nervous today about saying the wrong thing. Everybody's hypersensitive political correctness. I mean, you're dealing with a lot of ethnic issues with the promos. Is there a line you're scared to cross today?
I don't believe in being politically correct because I'm Mexican. I'm 100% Mexican. I was born and raised in Mexico. So in Mexico, one of my coworkers one day said, like, hey, I read something and now I understand you. And I say, what was it? It's like, oh, in Mexico, there's nothing off limits. And there's not. Okay. I don't believe in politicians. Right. I believe in like the whole immigration thing. I don't believe in. So I have no problem with not being politically correct.
He'll send
because
me
you
out
pick
there.
It.
Yeah. Yeah, he sends me out there having talking about, you know, hey, everybody make sure you bring your green cards to the show. Yeah. You don't bring your green card to the show, my daddy Donald Trump is gonna come down, he's gonna kick you, he's gonna send you right back over the border, right back to Mexico, and you know what I mean? I'll go whole nine yards, man.
Taking what life has given us, there's Donald Trump then, right? Mexicans will always love Mexico USA. That's our main audience, the Mexican fans. But our product's gotten, you know, good enough for other people interested, you know? We have diversity of people coming to the next show. And it's like, they will always want to cheer for Mexico. They always want the team to win, even if it isn't good. Right. You mentioned to them how Mexico lost to Chile 7-0 and they're going to go bananas.
Absolutely.
You know?
Yeah.
So you have a guy call himself a Gringo Loco, which in wrestling, that name was a group to like big legends. So that itself is a jab to them, right? Yeah. You have him talking about his daddy, Donald Trump, who right now is threatening to kick out all Mexicans. And these people, you know, they have this emotion because, I mean, the average Mexican people comes in, wake up, go to work, raise a family, you know,
yeah,
and it's a routine.
Blue collar, sure.
Take care, you know, go back home.
Wrestling always was a blue collar. Now when they touch thousands of dollars to go to WrestleMania, I find it ridiculous. Yeah.
So they can't tell, like, they can't go and tell Trump how they feel, they're going to do the next best thing. Go tell his son how they feel.
That's what's great about our profession is that, honestly, the whole thing about the line, we're allowed to blur those lines.
Right.
Because what you consider politically incorrect is just a hot button for us.
Right,
that's
right.
A perfect opportunity for Gringo Loco to go out there and upset you in that manner. Say we go to Cali and we're out there in the Golden State, you know what I'm saying? He can go out there and talk about how they choked against the Cavs. You know what I'm saying? It's a perfect opportunity to say, you know what, you guys don't want to talk about it? I'm going to talk about it. Let's talk about this. And then just those emotions come up and it makes for great entertainment.
Okay, well, instead of just talking, why don't we show briefly, we have two clips and we're going to check this out, folks, so you get a taste of Lucha Libre Promotions. Check it out. We'll be right back.
posible. No te quedes fuera de este gran evento.
No se lo puede perder un mano a mano entre Freddy contra Pentagón Junior.
Ustedes van a ser testigos.
Este mano a mano
que se ha vuelto increíble.
Más ustedes, ahí donde ustedes están.
Ahora en New York.
Así es que no se lo pueden perder. 24 de julio.
24 de julio.
La cita es en la Moon.
Winfield puro.
Cero.
Folks, I am an old school jaded fan. I've been going to wrestling since 1974, before some of these guys were born. And I recommend Lucha Libre Promotions. Come out and support something different. Great, great fun for the entire family. And any final plugs, guys?
Yeah, sure. Check us out this Sunday, July 24th at El Rey del Underground, at La Boom, 5615 Northern Boulevard. Follow us on Twitter at Lucha Libre Promotions, Lucha Libre Pro, Facebook, and YouTube, Lucha Libre Promotions NY. It's going to be a great show.
And Javier?
Oh, thank you. Thanks for having us. I'm really looking forward to having everyone come out to the show. Pentagon is going to be there. Phoenix is going to be there. We have a surprise one from
Lucha. And if you're not familiar with Lucha, these are world-class guys. These guys wrestle all over the world. So come out and support it.
Definitely. And you know, you enjoyed it, so I'm sure they will enjoy it. It's a fun, it's a family event. Yeah. So bring out the kids. And it's also an adult event, so you can come out. Have some beers, have some drinks. Yeah. It's for everyone.
And it has atmosphere. You kind of feel like you're in Mexico at a Lucha show. It's great.
And we're breaking also the politically correct. We're bringing in a black, gay person to wrestle at a Mexican show. So we want to see how
that's going to fly. Is that Sonny?
Sonny Kiss.
Yeah, he was on our show. He's great. Yeah.
He came here in a tutu, right?
He was dancing with the blues band. So it was great.
I mean, great talent there. I mean, we have a great show planned out. The environment itself is going to be something you haven't seen at an indie show. The wrestlers are coming to work hard. I mean, we've planned this not just yesterday. We've been for 2-3 months before our last show talking about the next show. It's going to be great. July 24th, La Boom. Check us out. Follow us on YouTube, Twitter, Facebook.
3 p.m.
There you go. Nice and early. I've been to indie shows where it ends like 12:30 at night. The kids are asleep. This is the way to do it. Absolutely. Yeah,
we do it a lot for the kids. Because we love the way the kids still get excited. Yeah. They hate the heels. And then the parents also have fun.
But at what point is throwing too much stuff, you know, frowned upon? Because you don't want to hurt anybody.
Yeah, don't throw
a load of beer.
Don't throw full beer unless it's in my hand.
That's right.
So you get last show, this kid just took a beer can and just threw it right at my head, just like baseball pitched it at me.
Yeah, I mean you don't want to get hit in the eye either. Yeah. I mean,
well, this time we're gonna do glass. So
okay, good idea.
That will not happen again. You'll be okay, my friend.
Right. Slot promoters think of every detail. There you go. That's an important detail.
Oh, but it'll be fun. We hope to see you over there.
I will be there. Say hello to yours truly. I'll be there. And looking forward to it.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.
My pleasure. Lucha Libre Promotion, support them. And when we come back, we're going to have live blues, live rock, poetry. Don't you dare go anywhere. More of the eclectic mix known as Legends TV after this very brief commercial time. One quick plug before we go to commercial. I have a movie out. It's called Wrestling Then and Now, the documentary. We filmed it quite a while back. And we have some great, great wrestlers in there. Killer Kowalski, Don Dr. Death Arnold, Nikolai Volkoff, Homicide, the late, great Tiger Khan. And you can check that out on Amazon. So that'll about it. Oh, one other quick plug. This is not a commercial. This is just a product I recommend. Formula G18 battles all kinds of disease. Our buddy Rob Russin was kind enough to send me this, Formula G18. So without further ado, we're going to take a quick commercial break. And we're going to be back with live music. Spare parts. Okay, we'll be right back.
From Evan Ginsberg, the associate producer of The Wrestler, starring Mickey Rourke, Wrestling Then and Now. Explores the real-life East Coast indie wrestling scene portrayed in The Wrestler, featuring legends old and new, Killer Kowalski, Nikolai Volkoff, Don Dr. Death Arnold, Kid USA, Brian Wolf, Casey Kavanaugh, Homicide, Low Life Louis Ramos, Randy the Rat Girl, and the Great Mambo King.
Future wrestling going, it's gonna be as disgusting as it can possibly get.
It's a three-way dance catfight style.
A must-see for both diehard fans as well as casual fans. Red Schwan, Wrestling Clothesline. A wonderful piece of history and art. I can't wait to watch it all over again. Dr. Mike Leno.
Sell it. Da-da.
It was great to see my old deceased friends, Killer Kowalski and Tiger Khan. Also great to see Evan Ginsberg, Don Arnold, and Jeff Archer. Lenny the Genius Poffo. You don't have to be a wrestling fan to enjoy. It's that good.
Pay attention to what I'm saying. You think you become what you feel you become to say you become.
Wrestling then and now.
It's everywhere, and it's almost like a movement.
Download or purchase DVD at walkertown.com. From Evan Ginsberg, the associate producer of The Wrestler, starring Mickey Rourke, Wrestling Then and Now. Explores the real-life East Coast indie wrestling scene portrayed in The Wrestler, featuring legends old and new, Killer Kowalski, Nikolai Volkoff, Don Dr. Death Arnold, Kid USA, Brian Walt, Casey Kavanaugh.
Galaxy Luxury Coach is a full-service limousine and party bus company. Family-owned and operated, we are an industry leader with over 25 years of experience in providing best-in-class luxury transportation for your special event. Whether it's your precious wedding day, an all-day wine tour out east, your high school prom, that special birthday, or just an amazing night on the town, our professional chauffeurs stand ready to ensure your special event is truly special. Galaxy Luxury Coach has one of the largest and modern party bus fleets in the New York area. Our party buses are simply nightclubs on wheels, concert sound systems, light shows, lasers and strobes, multicolor LED lighting brilliantly lights your party bus inside and out. For corporate and more laid-back events, we will cater to your specific needs and requests. What sets Galaxy aside from all others in the luxury transportation industry is our attention to detail in customizing our services to your special event. At Galaxy, it's all about you and your guests. Galaxy customers return time and time again because they know they can trust Galaxy to help deliver those lifetime memorable moments. Step aboard and let your Galaxy experience begin.
Hello, I'm Dr. G. I've established an organization called Voices for Veterans. We use music to honor veterans and to help the public understand what veterans have gone through when they come home from war. On October 22nd of this year, we're going to have an incredible show, a 3.5-hour concert at Molloy College, one of the greatest 500-seat theaters on Long Island. We're going to honor 25 veterans. We've taken an incredible band, 15 people from Long Island, some of the best musicians we could find, and we merged it with a 30-person choir, merging gospel with rock and roll. This incredible 3.5-hour show is like none other that you've ever seen. This is Grammy quality. October 22nd, you can buy a ticket, you can make a donation, you can get involved, you can help us with the committee. You can look us up at v4veterans.org and go on our website and get all the information about the show. Please make a difference to these veterans by coming aboard with us with Voices for Veterans. Thank you so much.
Shattuck Gates is the number one fence provider on Long Island with the most inventory in stock, including vinyl chain link, and Aluminum Gates offers a custom powder-coated system that prevents rust throughout the life of the fence. We carry fence tools to the trade. We even stock wood, rail, and glass hardware as well. Shannon Gates has our very own patented locking system. The next time you need fencing of any sort, both commercial and private, give Shannon Gates a call at 631-392-4330. You can also visit our website at shannongatesinc.com.
I'm your Lucha Libre Promotions Champion, Gringo Loco, and allow me to introduce to you, Spare Parts.
Yeah.
John, you want to come up and do some stuff?
Okay, dig it. This is called Love and Violence. Between love and violence, the rat-a-tap-tap of a hidden drum, keeping time in a ghost dance. In the glade's shadow of afternoon, green textile tongues shouting, licking dreams of hope and broken glass. Molly sheds real tears that drip along the crevices of her tender face. She asks for relief, seeking light on this bitter day. The aftermath of fallen words. Morphine-addicted pestilence, precious liquid embrace removes her from the pain. I am no longer part of your world, she says. Tomorrow I'll be free. Drifting between waves of innocence and sorrow. Coyote escapes us all. Try to catch a cloud or a whisper, and that's left is a hand filled with glitter. We strive for reason in chaos, surrounded by madness. The hope for answers to questions shaken from trees and birds. Why doesn't the sun shine at midnight? Somewhere it does. And yet also, it snows somewhere in August. What's down is up, and up, down. We accept each other like smells, conveniently keeping quiet as we hold our noses and still cuddle and kiss, waiting for the morning paper. Out and about, eyes covered, just a hint of blue. All this confusion, mixed up notions, only time, with its blood-soaked hands, will clarify. On the steps leading to the roof, a speckled moth spins furiously, trying to break free of a spider's trap. I watch and do nothing. The morning sun captures its silent body. If only I'd offered a careful tug, the now lifeless carcass would still be trying to catch moonbeams. Afternoon heat. Angry white light makes eyes sweat. Hands tingle with paralysis. Heart pumps, lungs and throat ache, scratchy with solitude. Avenues are canyons in the crystal concrete, blistering, unrepentant. We swim through a parade of sorrows, each bearing pain the city caresses as a hungry cat. Each step a reminder of struggle, dizzy, the careless breezes that reek of swirling smoke and sulfur. Rush of sounds bouncing, relenting off steel, hustle of noise and regret. Voices raised in momentary terror. Darkness, angry, swims in scratchy solitude, covered and baked in blood. Nothing makes sense or holds the attention of the angels. And I'll read one more to bring everything down. It's called The Song for Chanel. I could hear your laughter, the warmth of your eyes that held me before sunlight entered through the parted curtains. 10 years of magic, I held you in summer, autumn, as the seasons began to change, and your star in Sagittarius shone its light. A protective glow that held your children within its circle. And while the city rumbles through another lightning storm, know that the silent riddles of the clouds are hidden in your hands. Thanks. Thanks, fellas.
Thank you. gonna tell you a story about a little girl I met a long time ago. We went for a whirl. Oh, she's begging me now, baby. Ooh, she's begging, come on home. Well, she's my little mama, girl, girl, girl. Hey, well, let's get back on that trail. Can I get a little more vocals in there? Hey, well, once there was a little time, long time ago, I saw that little girl. I didn't know her from go. I said, oh, baby, won't you please come on with me now? That's what I said. That's what I said to her. I said, well, come along, little baby, now, yeah. Oh, come on, come on with me. She said, listen here now, man. This is the way it goes. I'm gonna do my thing. One will never, never, never know. I said, come on, baby. Don't you play with me. She said, listen here, boy. There ain't nothing, nothing in the world but me. That's what she said. Come on now, tell me, Alpha. What did she say now? Come on. What she said. Hey, I said, do you want to take a ride? Be a big surprise. We'll go up to the mountains. Oh, we're gonna watch the sunrise. Yes, we are now. I said, oh, baby. I said, baby, come on with me. No, I'm gonna set you free, yeah. That's what I'm gonna do. Hey, come on now, come on, baby, come on, please, come on, baby, take a walk with me. I said, oh, come on, girl, won't you, come on with me? Yes, I did. She said, listen here, big fella. Ah, you're gonna listen to me. Oh, yes, you are. Well, now I said, Alpha, what you got for me? Let's play them six strings. Like you wanna be here with me, I said, come on with me now. Come on with me today. Well, I got my boys up here now with me, baby. Oh, yeah. And they're gonna play. Oh, yes, they are. I think you're ready for another one. One more time, come on. We'll be right back. What you think now? I said, come on, baby. Come on, take a ride. We're going down to see Evan Ginsberg. Ha! It's gonna be a big surprise. I said, oh, I said, come on, baby. Yeah, Mr. John Wanell gonna be there too. Oh, yes, he is. Well, we got all the wrestlers here, baby. Oh, yes, we do. It's called the Eclectic Mix. Yes, it is. Right here in the madhouse. I said, listen to me, baby. Listen to me, huh? I ain't joking this time. Come on into the yard. I said, oh, come on, baby, now. Oh, come on. Come on with me. Well, I know you're gonna love me, baby. Oh, you know I'm gonna set you free. Oh, yes I am, yes I am. Yeah, take a little walk. Calm yourself down. I wanna erase that thing on your head. They call a frown. Oh, I know. It's got to change, baby. You've got to change your evil ways. Well, if you wanna hang out with me, baby, ooh, you know the price you gotta pay. Uh-huh. Yes, you do. Yes, you do. I said, what you think, baby? You're thinking hard. You know I'm here working every day. Every day I'm working hard. I said, you gotta listen, listen, baby. You better listen, listen, listen to me. No matter how you're thinking, baby, oh, these planets don't revolve around you. No, no, they don't. Yeah, you gotta change your ways. Change them, huh? Think what you're doing. It really ain't that hard, I said. Come on, baby. Ooh. Well, take that little journey with me. Well, you know I'm gonna tell you, baby. And at the end of the day, you know I'm gonna set you free. Yes, we are. Well, it's time to wrap it all up now. I wanna thank Inbed. I don't know their names. Maybe you come on up and give it a whirl. Come on, you wanna introduce your little guest over here now. Come on, Evan, tell him. What is gonna be?
The great Tommy Maher, Tommy Maher. Barry G. Presser on drums. Alpha Halverson, the great Alpha Halverson, a regular on the show. And you can see Alpha every Sunday at Patty's in Flushing. Give the address, Alpha.